that.
Exactly.
If I just got back from Washington, and it's unbelievable what's going on. I mean, but I thought it might be useful to everybody to kind of say, how did we get here? You know, how did we let a country completely collapse? And why didn't we know that this was happening? You know, how
Well,
did that?
and also, Suzanne, how you got there in terms of you taking this up as a cause, that would
Oh,
be useful
brother.
and nice to
Yeah.
know.
What I would like to say about that is, I wish I had studied the French or something like that. Yeah. Getting involved with the Afghans has been a whole other thing. But I'm just going to share my screen for a second to give you guys some background. Can you see that?
Nope.
Okay, I don't think I did it right. Hold on, just bear
You
with
have to
me.
give her permission, Mike.
Share screen. Okay. Share, and then I'm going to hit.
There we
Let's
go.
see if that works. Can you see that?
Yep.
You can see that. Okay.
Got it.
So the reason the country collapsed, really, there are three main reasons. One is the state building strategy. That's what I'm going to talk about today, because I think that's most relevant. The development program is a hot mess. The military, I defend with my very being. I think that they did an excellent job over there, the US military, that is. But with the failure of the development program and the state building, they really didn't have a shot. You know, there was nothing really we could do. So here you've got a map of Afghanistan. And the thing that drives this country, that hardwires it more than anything else that you can imagine, is ethnicity. If I get resumes, the resume will be the last page might have a degree or some professional qualifications. The first three pages will be ethnicity and who their family is.
Well,
So ethnicity is the draw. This is what makes this country run. Here's a little picture of a Hazara boy. I'll get to that in a second. Okay, let me just do one more thing. I have to do a slideshow here. So the Pashtuns in this green, this kind of pea green color, this color, the Pashtuns are the elite of the society. They have held all of the economic power for hundreds of years. The Hazaras, the blue, are the most marginalized group in the country. And the Hazaras are very easy to spot. They don't look like the other Afghans. They're very mongoloid looking because they're Chinese, you know, they've come from China. The Hazaras are also Shia. So they are marginalized because they look different. They're marginalized because they practice a different realm of Islam.
and
And
that's a
they're
big chunk of the country.
Yes, not a lot of it's a big chunk of the country. It's also a sizable population of Hazaras. There is a sizable population. And one of the myths that we've always heard is that the Pashtuns are the majority. They are not the majority. They hold all the economic and political power, but they're not the majority. The Tajiks, Uzbek, and Turkmen come from the northern part of the country. They look very Russian. And so what you have then is a situation where you had this country, it is hardwired with nothing but ethnicity. There's really not a, there are rich Pashtuns, there are poor Pashtuns, rich Tajiks, poor Tajiks, but everybody identifies with their ethnic identity. When we invaded in October 7th, 2001, and you guys probably all remember that day. The US is, we've got to respond to 9/11. And so President Bush asked the Joint Chiefs of Staff to come up with a plan. You know, how are we going to do this? And the Joint Chiefs of Staff come back and they say, we need 130,000 American troops. We're going to invade from the south to the north. And President Bush says, oh, no, we're not. I'm not risking one American life in this situation. We're going to let the Afghans have to come in. They've got to fight. It's partly them. We are there to do one thing and one thing only. We're going to kill bin Laden, and then we're going to leave. So a colleague of mine was in the region. He had helped negotiate the withdrawal of the Russians from Afghanistan. They were there from 79 to 89. And he had gotten very friendly and very involved with the Northern Alliance, the group of Tajiks, Uzbeks, and the Hazaras as well in the north. And these guys were already fighting the Taliban. They were running out of money. They needed hay for their horses. They were really tapped out. They couldn't do much more. And so he got in touch with CENTCOM and he said, look, these guys are already fighting the Taliban. And so CENTCOM said, well, what do they need? Give us a list of what they need. And CENTCOM is expecting them to come in with tanks and guns. And they come in with, no, we need dogs. We need hay for the horses. We need a way to sort of transport bullets. We're doing it in cardboard boxes, but we probably need containers. And so initially, the U.S. government, you know, the military is kind of surprised by this. This is a fairly primitive situation, but they've already successfully pushed the Russians out. So they can fight. They know what they're doing. The president agreed to have them fight. What we would do is we would send in the military and they would do airstrikes. And the airstrikes, and then the Afghans, the Northern Alliance fighters, would do all the ground fighting. And so the CIA arrives in a plane and they get off the plane and the Afghan generals of the Northern Alliance are standing there and they're saying, well, where are the real men? These guys have like Italian shoes on, leather jackets. We want, you know, where are the American men? I mean, what are these guys going to do? But they had boxes in their hands. And so the Afghans are saying, well, what are those boxes that those, you know, who are these people anyway? And the boxes were computers. And so the CIA agents, there were roughly 100 CIA agents. They got off the planes and they started to talk through interpreters to Rashid Dostum, who was the general from the Uzbek group. Massoud had been killed. He was a very famous war hero in Afghanistan. He was killed on September 10th, right, the day before the attack on America. Mohaqiq, who was the Hazara leader, was there. And they're, they're explaining to them, here's how it's going to work. These boxes that we hold have all the coordinates of your country, and you're going to tell us what coordinates to hit, and we're going to bomb those coordinates, and we're going to take out the enemy, and then you guys will go in terms of the ground troops, and you'll fight, you know, you'll do the dirty work. So, after a lot of fips and starts, because the translations are, you know, a little bit difficult to make, the translators on the Afghan side have never seen a computer. So the translation about what these boxes are going to do got to be a little bit tricky. The battle starts, and the first thing that happens is the bomber pilot in the air, American, says, tell me what the coordinates are. And the Afghans freeze. They get terrified. Because this is the voice of a woman. And at first they think it's a lie. They think this is really just the most unbelievable thing they've ever heard. And then the translator says, no, this is an American woman. She is one of our best trained bomber pilots. She is a top graduate of our military academy. And the Afghans then say, we're not going to fight. We refuse to put anything behind letting a woman do our fighting. This is just, the Americans are strange, but this is just this, you know, takes it over the edge. The bomber pilot is circling, you know, and the fuel is really, you know, it's very scarce because the Afghans don't have any power source in the country. So we're importing all of this. And she keeps saying, you know, I'm running out of fuel. Give me the coordinates. Give me the coordinates. And finally, the Americans say to the Afghan, look, this is, you just give her the coordinates. Let's just get on with it. And then we'll sort out this gender problem here later, but we've got to get this fight underway. And so finally, the Afghans give her the coordinates. She hits every target. And Dostum, who is the general, the Uzbek general, gets on the radio and he realizes he can talk to the Taliban. And he says to the Taliban, okay, you see what we just did to you. And basically, she took out every target. She killed quite a few people. He said, an American woman did that. Just wait until the American men get here and see what we're going to do. We're going to, you know, going to kill you. We're going to beat your ass to the ground. So that really illustrates the cultural difference that we had when we first went over there. There was not going to be kind of a smooth understanding of the culture. This was a very different culture. But the bottom line was the Northern Alliance cleared off the entire northern part of the country. They had, they lost 3,000 men doing it, same as we did here in the US on 9/11. And they were absolutely won over by the Americans. And one of the reasons that they were won over was they felt like the Americans understand us. They're now going to come into the country. They're going to readjust this horrible Pashtun hegemony that we've been living with. And the Americans are going to federalize. You know, we're going to have a constitution. We're going to have a new government. But we're going to federalize the country. And we're going to have the various regions in the country represented very much akin to the American political system, which they understood very well. The governors would have, as Americans, we have governors, we have mayors, we have a president, we have a Congress. And so they understood that finally this hegemony would be challenged, that the groups that had not had any economic power, particularly Hazaras, who really were the slaves. For those of you that saw The Kite Runner, you sort of see that play out with the Hazara family. So the what happened was our representatives, the NATO representatives, the U.S. representatives had to pick an interim government. You know, we had to figure out, all right, what are we going to do here? So we had a meeting in Bonn, Germany, and the Afghans were the most important people at this meeting because they convened a group of seven who were really kind of the natural leaders of the country. One of them was King Zaire. He had ruled from 1923 to 1965. By the time 2001 rolled around, King Zaire had been living in France. He was deposed by his cousin who had communist leanings. So he had had some very good years in France. And King Zaire was beloved. He kind of kept all of these ethnic groups relating to one another. He modified kind of hegemony, but all of that really changed with this sort of 10 years of turmoil. At any rate, this committee of seven met, and they actually nominated a guy named Mohammed Sharat to be the president, the interim president. Sharat was a college professor at the Kabul University. He had done undergraduate work here in the U.S. and at Columbia. And then he had a PhD in Islamic studies. He was very, very well respected by everybody, Pashtuns, Tajiks, everybody. And so the Afghans said, in terms of our interim government, we'll put this guy forward. He's going to be the best we have. The Pashtuns went berserk. And they said, you can never have a non-Pashtun president. Absolutely not. It will never work. And one of the biggest proponents of this was Khalilzad, who became our representative. He was an American citizen, Afghan born. He's the guy that negotiated the withdrawal of the American troops under Trump. So Khalilzad was a well-known, very, very much a Pashtun, and his sensibility over this completely dominated. And so Sharat's nomination was kiboshed. The most inconsequential person at this meeting was Hamid Karzai. But Hamid Karzai was a Pashtun. His father was actually the superstar, not him. And so Karzai was he wasn't really elected because every other representative of this Afghan group walked out. They walked out. The what happened next is that the narrative began. The narrative begins. And this is really where American foreign policy starts to go south very early on. And the narrative was these Tajiks, Uzbeks, Hazaras, they're warlords, they eat children, they're going to destabilize the country, they want to kill everybody, they want their ethnic group to prevail, and none of this was true at all. All these other groups wanted was representation. The Constitution then had to be rethought, and so with this sort of Pashtun hegemony back, we adopted a constitution that was akin to the 1964 constitution with all of the power concentrated in the presidency. The president appoints the governors. The president appoints the mayors. The mayors are allegedly supposed to be elected. None of them were. The president goes so far as to appoint local officials like where school boards exist. He appoints that as well. So these communities become extremely disenfranchised. And this happens over time. As the leaders of these communities become marginalized, the security situation really starts to deteriorate. Here's 2003. Most of the country is free. Dostum and the Northern Alliance had cleared it out. Kandahar is a real hot spot. And, you know, as Dostum said to the Americans, we need six more weeks to go into Kandahar and Jalalabad. We're going to get the Taliban leaders out. Here's 2004. We've now got 18,000 American troops there. And the security situation is getting worse. Here's 2005. Security situation is getting worse. Here's 2007. It's getting worse. 2008, it gets worse. 2009, it gets worse. 2010, it gets worse. Until finally, around 2011, when Obama is elected, most of the country now, aside from Kabul, has been kind of usurped by the Taliban. All the rural areas are pretty much gone. Dostum has had to leave the country. Mohaqiq is kind of at home. The Tajik leader, Abdullah, you saw the fiasco with John Kerry. That election of Abdullah, the election was really rigged, and Abdullah objected, and finally Kerry made him a co-president, it was just ridiculous. My point here is that what we began to do early on is we failed to understand that we had an opportunity to actually convene a loya jirga, to have these other ethnic groups participate, and to build the country on that perspective. The Constitution was ratified in 2004, and basically it gave us exactly what will turn out to be a real disaster: Pashtun hegemony, the disenfranchisement of the majority of the country. And so that, I think, is part of what I would want to say to you. That's the background.
Suzanne, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
So there was certainly some awareness on the part of the Americans back at the early period about the Northern Alliance and the different ethnicities and all of that, and it's kind of, maybe it shouldn't be surprising, but it doesn't seem impossible that somebody would have said, wait a second, we've got to, I guess they would have had to push back really hard on the Pashtuns and their resistance. I mean, what do you think could have been done differently back in that early period?
You know, that's a great question. Rumsfeld got it. Rumsfeld understood this very, very well. He understood two things. One, if in fact we were ever going to withdraw from the country and really, if this country could become fairly independent and definitely defend themselves from extremism, then these groups were what we needed. In the State Department, you basically had a lot of, including Khalilzad, who really made the case that you that these ethnic groups were illiterate. They were, again, you know, warlords. They had destroyed Kabul. And part of that, when the Russians withdrew, a civil war broke out. So you had the northern groups fighting one another. They did, Kabul was in ruins when we actually first went there. So, but you had this narrative among, and I would say that I actually understand the comfort level that the State Department had with Pashtuns. They all spoke English. And yeah, most of them had been educated here. So you were talking to people that had gone to Columbia University that spoke English, that really lived in the United States longer than they had in Afghanistan. Okay. So there was that kind of ability to make the case. The Northern Alliance, Rashid Dostum doesn't speak a word of English. Everything has to be done through his translator, who is really terrific, but it's a very tedious, slow go.
So Rumsfeld could, I assume, try to make the better case and just lost, right?
He lost. He lost to the State Department, who had this sort of pro-Pashtun ability, I would say, to really have our foreign policy based on kind of this stereotype.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, I can tell you, I brought Mohammad Mohaqiq here, the Hazara leader, and he was actually, he gave a speech at Quantico. He was talking to our military leaders, but there were a lot of human rights people there too. I mean, it was a very mixed audience. And Mohaqiq was asked, well, you know, civilians, the American military is killing Afghan civilians. And Mohaqiq said, yeah, it's a war. That's what happens. Civilians die. And the human rights groups went berserk. Mm. And I'm saying to myself, have any of these people ever been in a war zone? I don't think so. I mean, this is what happens. The other thing about Mohaqiq, when I brought him here, we went and we did a network interview, and you know, we get there and it's 6 o'clock, and Mohaqiq brings out his prayer rug and he gets down on the floor and starts praying, and the producers go berserk. They said, hey, you know what? This is costing us a lot of money. You know, every minute this guy's on the floor praying. I mean, this is like advertising revenue. I mean, get this guy off the floor and get him in. That's kind of what I'm saying, in a way, that the Pashtuns, you're dealing with polished, educated people, and these other groups are very different. You know, they haven't been exposed to any kind of a Western sentiment. So I think the state building strategy was, again, you know, I'm not saying we bet on the wrong horse, because I don't think it's about betting on the wrong horse. I really think it's about creating a structure that allows all ethnic groups to have a voice in this new Afghanistan. Let them fight this out in a political situation.
Do you think that if that had somehow been worked out initially, that would have led to more of a civil war?
No.
No?
I think initially it would have been, it's interesting in my mind, because federalizing the government or the governance is a lot like Islam. And one of the principles of Islam is cooperation. You must reach a consensus. And I've never seen anything like this except in Afghanistan. I mean, they literally will battle one another, but then in an Islamic context, they will always reach a consensus. They're brothers. This is how the religious part plays. So federalizing the country is a lot like Islam, in my mind. I mean, I don't think there's anything different. And I've seen some pretty awful conflicts resolved through these forums, where literally it definitely works. The way we can understand the collapse of the country is that once the Americans get there, we realize, you know, we've got to create an Afghan army. We can't stay forever. The Afghans have to defend themselves. And the leaders, the political leaders, understood this. And their armies were absolutely loyal. They were effective. And they had a sense of what they were fighting for. Once we started to create the Afghan army from scratch, it was a slow and impossible go. One of the military guys I talked to on my last trip, one of his jobs was to evaluate the readiness of the Afghan army. And he said, you know, I wasn't the only one that did that. We would look at where we were. And, you know, we realized they still were like the gang that couldn't shoot straight. I mean, they were awful. And we had been there for 10 years. And we had spent billions of dollars on this army. So I had a checklist, and I went down the checklist, you know, can they shoot? No. Can they, you know, can they drive a tank? No. Can they, you know, all this stuff. And I submitted this to my commanding officer, and the commanding officer said, this will never go up the chain. Never. We've spent too much money in this place creating this army. We're not going to tell it people in Washington that they can't do anything.
But nobody figured that out sooner before you did that?
You know, I think what happened was it was kind of like a hardware store. You had a problem. And one of the big problems was the desertion rate. By 2000 and probably 2008, I think 50 or 60% of all Afghan recruits into the army deserted within a month. Mm. And what they were doing is they were deserting and they were selling everything to the Taliban. Because that was the only way to make money. So they would sell their guns, their uniforms, their ammunition, and then they would come back and re-enlist. And that was really becoming a problem. Mm. So the U.S. Said, you know, this is awful. We have to do something about it. We have to stop this. So they introduced retina recognition software, which meant every new recruit, you'd take a picture of their eyeball. So if they tried to re-enlist, you'd say, no, you've already enlisted. We're not going to let you back. And that had some impact on cutting back on this. You know, when we left Afghanistan in August of 2021, this software was left at Bagram Air Force Base. And it has been a terrible weapon. It's allowed the Taliban to find people that were loyal to the U.S. Not only did we load soldiers' eyeballs into that, but we started loading other, the interpreters are all in that system. And in Afghanistan, there's no administrative system. So you can't send a letter anywhere. You know, you have to say, this is the Akbar neighborhood in Kabul. It's next to the, you know, whatever mosque. You have to.
So somebody could have destroyed that system before we left.
And we didn't. We left it at Bagram. We walked away. So somebody
on the ground, you know, those kinds of things are not necessarily high up decisions. It would seem to me that somebody on the ground just completely blew it.
You know, I'll tell you, the problem was I talked to the guy who was the last soldier out, and he's a very high level intelligence guy. And they had briefed, you know, they briefed Trump, obviously. Trump said, we're getting out. And they had a whole briefing with him. And they said, Mr. President, we've got, you know, we've really got a lot of people that we've got to get out. We can do it. Here's the phasing, phase one, phase two, phase three. And all of this is predicated on keeping Bagram, because at Bagram, we've got the, you know, we've got huge planes at Bagram, and we're going to load the tanks onto the planes. We're not going to leave anything behind. And the only sort of what we should really leave behind and actually be somewhat proud of are the pilots that we train. The Afghan pilots are like the cream of the crop. They are really smart. They can still do airstrikes, and they will stave off the Taliban's encroachment, and they'll probably do a pretty decent job. The Army, you know, we're still not sure how good they're going to be, but the pilots are going to do a great job. But we have to leave the contractors. The American contractors have to stay, because if the American contractors don't stay, the planes won't be maintained. Nothing will be maintained. So we've got to leave the contractors. If we leave the contractors, we've got to protect them. So we'll keep them at Bagram. We'll protect them. And we also have a very substantial CIA operation. And we've embedded that in the Ariana Hotel, which is the luxury hotel, you know, again, relative terms, luxury. But in Kabul, we've sort of put them in there because we want to hide them. You know, we don't want them to be so obvious. Biden gets elected, they go back, they give him the whole briefing, and they say, you know, all of this is predicated. We've got to, you know, Bagram is our end game. You know, we've got to have Bagram. So this guy tells me, he gets to Afghanistan and his guys pick him up. They drive through, he gets to, I think he flies into Tashkent. They drive down, and he said, you know, hopefully the officer's quarters is there. You know, it's where I usually go. And they tell him, oh, wait a minute, we're not at Bagram. He said, what? What do you mean we're not at Bagram? And it's at that moment that he's told that Biden has made this decision that we're going to give up Bagram, and we're going to do the entire evacuation from the tuna fish can that is Karzai Airport. And
so that happened from the time they did the briefing of Biden to the time he went back to the country?
Yes. Wow. Biden, I mean, this hopefully will come out in the hearings. You know, what? You know, I have pictures of what we blew up. It's probably in the billions of dollars, I would have to say. I mean, I don't know the cost of tanks or anything like that, but and we still left most of our equipment there, because we left Bagram.
So Biden said, and he must have been advised accordingly, I don't think it came out of only his brain, it never does. He must have been advised that, no, that's going to be too slow or too risky to hold on to Bagram or something.
We don't know.
Yeah.
All we know is that the best military intelligence had a whole plan to get everybody out. And it could only happen at Bagram. And, you know, you saw what happened at Karzai Airport. Biden has always been against this war for a long time. When he was a senator, he opposed going in, I think. And so he's always surrounded himself with people that think that way. And I think his advice really came from Blinken and people like that who agreed with him. And he appeared not to listen to his top military people. I mean, and you saw what happened, you know, 13 American soldiers were killed. I can't tell you the number of Afghans that were killed. I think it's about 200, and it's probably closer to 300 at this point, because when those explosions went off, it was hard to know. I had a friend whose brother and sister-in-law lost both of their sons in the blast. And one son, the body was just there. So they saw that son, they knew. The second son, they couldn't find. I was looking all over for this kid. They were hoping he had somehow gotten on a plane and gotten to a military hospital here. We went to Walter Reed in DC. We were looking all over the place. We couldn't find the kid. And finally, we figured out there were mass graves dug in Kabul. And, people were just, bodies were just put into the, and that's where we think the second son ended up. But I think it's just awful. I mean, to see the collapse of the country. But again, I mean, we knew this was coming. We had to leave in 2009. I mean, Obama came in and he did the surge. He put, we went from, I think, 30,000 American troops to 100,000 American troops and 30,000 NATO troops. And Obama's theory was we would surge the country, we'd push the Taliban back, and then the Afghan army could probably take over and run things. And that
so the difference, but the difference would have been if Biden had listened to that advice, then they could have gotten everybody or a lot of people out. It would have been much less disorderly, and all of that is hugely important. But it also wouldn't it also be the case that even with that, the country still would have, the army still would have collapsed, if that's the right word, anyway?
Yeah, I agree. The country is, I think, when you add the failure of the development program to the state building failure, you can really see the constellation. You know, it's a perfect storm of failure.
Yeah.
So the country would have collapsed anyway. It was inevitable. You disenfranchised all these other ethnic groups, all these other ethnic leaders that could actually do a thing or two.
Yeah.
So you had no power structure. When Biden did the surge, one of the things about the surge was that the U.S. military got a lot of money to go into the villages and to win the hearts and minds of villagers. So they would go in and build, you know, they dig a well or something like that. And the first battle of the Obama surge was in a place called Marja. And Marja, southern part of the country, a Taliban stronghold, the U.S. military was there. And they were going to make a big show of Marja. And I remember thinking, you know, the governor of Marja is like the biggest knucklehead I know. This guy has very mixed loyalties. The Taliban, he's on their payroll. I knew this. So what is the governor of Marja going to do? The idea that the Obama administration had was once we took territory, we would come in with something they called government in a box, literally. And the government in the box was local funding. You know, we're going to build a school. We're going to do this. We're going to help local villagers kind of have some autonomy here. We're going to send community organizers in this box. This was the idea. So the Battle Marja starts. And the first thing that happens is this guy in a turban comes out on the road that the U.S. military is going to go down to start the battle. And he's waving his hands and he says, don't go down that road because the Taliban have laid IEDs all along that road and they're going to blow up every tank you have and every American soldier you have. So the American military is going, wow, this is great. The villagers are now cooperating with us. You know, they're on our side. They're going to help us. And it turns out that the Taliban needed a little bit more time to take a couple of tanks out before the Americans went down that road. And they sent this guy out to lie to the military. My point here is that the Northern Alliance, the local leaders, these guys knew everybody. They knew who was who. They knew what was what. And not to rely on that power structure that was well established and was crazy.
Yeah.
Here you had the U.S. military trying to broker relationships with local villagers who didn't know what end was up. I mean, they listened to the leaders. They listened to the Hazara villagers, listened to Mohawkic. Whatever Mohawkic says, this is what they do. The northern groups listened first to Massoud, then obviously to Dostum. They were the ones that could sort of sort all of this out. And we made the decision to marginalize them, to disenfranchise them, to not even give them a chance to help rebuild the country that they had fought for.
Yeah.
So I think your points are well taken, but the as you guys probably know, you know, I organized funds. We built an oil refinery, and it was located in Mazir Sharif, Sherbagon, in the northern part of the country. And the country has no power source. So every single time, I mean, you know, the Kabul was really a bubble. All of that power was imported. It was all imported diesel. So this oil refinery, Afghanistan has oil. It doesn't have the supply that, you know, the Saudi Arabia has. It doesn't have the quality. But nonetheless, it was a very, very important source. Because it was in the north, I didn't get this at first. It took me a while to realize this. We couldn't get a production sharing agreement. And I remember meeting with the finance minister, the Afghan finance minister, and he turned to me and he said, "You're working with those people." And I thought, oh my God, he's talking about one of our investors who's a Saudi. And we told this investor he wasn't allowed to talk to the Afghans because he's a knucklehead. And he probably did. That's what I thought. But then I started to realize, oh, he's talking about the Uzbeks, this guy's Pashtun. This is never going to happen. So the dysfunction of that sort of inability to understand what drove this country. I mean, we made so many mistakes there, and I think we will repeat them all again. Now, this is not the first time we've done this. It always makes me think of Vietnam, you know, not getting behind Ho Chi Minh, when the CIA was very pro Ho Chi Minh. You know, they said, this is the guy to get behind. He's a leader. And we didn't do that. We instead created an elite army. We created an elite government in Vietnam. And then when we left, it was very similar. You know, we left really in disgrace.
Yeah, so part of it is the even giving us the credit, which we didn't always deserve for being well-intentioned. Part of it was just a real difficulty understanding other cultures, particularly ones that are significantly different than ours.
I think so, yeah. And kind of not understanding kind of what we were actually seeing. Why would the Pashtuns so object to a person like Mohammad Sharat, who was a college professor, who was well-respected? Why would they dig in their heels against somebody like that? You know, what's that about? And not getting deeper beyond this explanation, predominantly at that point by Khalizad and the other Pashtuns. And the idea that we would condone a constitution that concentrated all power in the presidency. I mean, that's a recipe for disaster. I explain this to my students. I always tell them, you know, here's what that means. Let's say Obama was president and he appointed Susan Rice to be governor of Alaska. She's never lived in Alaska. She grew up in Manhattan. She went to private school. And she goes to Alaska. And the first thing she says is, "Ooh, moose meat, high cholesterol. I'm going to ban it. That's not good for you." And then she says, "Oh, my God, snowmobiles, terrible for the environment. I'm going to ban snowmobiles." Yeah. And she goes ahead and does that. This is exactly what happened.
Same idea. Yeah.
Wow. The regional differences are, they are different. People in, and the sad part about this is the northern groups are much more, they have a lot more affinity for the West. Southern Pashtuns. I mean, these are the Taliban is Pashtun. You know, they tend to be much more religiously conservative. Not
yeah,
the
what an irony, huh? Man.
Yeah. Yeah. But at any rate, I wanted to let you guys ask some more of your really great questions because
why did you get so involved in this? And were you, obviously you were accepted.
It's like such a lot. Well, here's how I got involved. It just goes to show you that every day in life, anything can change. Yeah. So I'm watching the news one morning, and I always had to watch the traffic report because I needed to know what bridge to take. You know, if there was an accident on one bridge, I had to take another. So I'm listening half-heartedly, kind of putzing around. And Karen News is broadcasting from Kabul with Pola Dobryansky. And they're talking about the development program in Afghanistan. You know, it's probably like 2005, 2004. And, you know, I'm half-heartedly listening. I'm thinking, oh, come on, let's get on with it. Tell me what bridge to take. I don't care about this. And I'm listening, and I realize they're describing a welfare program, a very expensive welfare program. Hmm. And I start listening to this, and I'm thinking, oh, my God, this is a mess. So I got to work. And I got in touch with Karen Hughes, and you know, I said, I saw you on the Today Show. It was pre-broadcast, so she was back in Washington. I said, you know, this is really very disconcerting. I spent a good part of my early career trying to dismantle the welfare system, the more egregious parts of it. And to see that we're building another welfare system in a foreign country when we've got the opportunity to do something so much better, I just don't get it.
Yeah.
So she said, well, come and talk to us. So I went down, and Pola Dobryansky was the head of global affairs at the State Department. And Pola is really very academic and very smart. And she said to me, well, tell me how can we hire you to write a report? I said, that's the problem. You don't need a report here. You've got a warehouse full of those things. What you need is high-risk investors. You need people that are going to step in and take enormous risks that are American, because we need this. You're not building any sectors. You're not building economic sectors here. You're building a bunch of programs. And this is like, you know, we'll never have self-sufficiency.
But Suzanne, so this is early on, and you're just getting going with your involvement. So
yes.
Had already kind of figured that some of this stuff out then.
Well, you know, only because I saw the problems with the welfare system here.
Yeah.
So in my own mind, I had kind of a reference, you know, I had sort of an idea that this is not the way to do it. I mean, you know, we need to build sectors. And then I found out that there wasn't any power in the country. I thought, well, how in the world are you going to have any business development if you don't have a power source? That's kind of stupid. I mean, the Swedes had built some hydroelectric power plants in the 60s. So, but these things were really in disrepair. You know, nothing was happening. So that was kind of how I got started.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, you know, we couldn't, I mean, you're looking at, that's a picture of a couple of Afghan engineers. Those are oil drums. That guy in the middle, is that family, where there's gas, there's oil. If you remember from geology, I had to actually learn the whole, gas and oil business, which was really fun because it's so straightforward. You know, it's not like the kind of things we deal with. It's like, here's the reserves, here's what you have to frack, here's what you know, it's very straightforward. So where there's gas, there's oil. And the Russians had built a beautiful gas plant in northern Afghanistan, which was in real disrepair. This is a kid who had to stay up all night, and that was his job. He was not allowed to really sleep, only little naps, because he had to make sure that gas flame didn't go out. Because once that went out, his father's bakery wouldn't be able to produce any bread. Mm. So that was his, I mean, this is the level of the primitive, this was just disgraceful, really. So it's a long story. The development failure is a whole different, you know, that's a whole other sequence of problems that occurred. Another mess. And then I came back. I mean, we really, once we realized that, I mean, at one point we said to ourselves, you know what, the whole thing has to fall apart. And when it falls apart, God only hope that the Afghans can rebuild it. But this paradigm is failing. It is failing big time. And we knew that this was going to happen. We knew this.
Did you have a group of people that were kind of working together with you, like some kind of organization?
Group of people. We formed a couple of, we formed a consortium. In the course of all of this, I mean, one of the things my investors wanted to do, they wanted actually to see if we could finish projects. So they said, find out everything that's being done over there. And I did, actually. It was astounding to me. And some of the people I met were so terrific. I would say the staff of the Asian Development Bank, they were top notch. One guy we worked closely with was a geologist. So people were seeing this failure. It was mostly on the U.S. side, because we had much more money involved in this than anybody else. The U.S. government did. The leadership was awful on the U.S. side, awful. And in comparison to our European counterparts, it was at times it got to be an embarrassment. And I remember once I was going back to the State Department, and you know, I had a sense of everything that they had started and what had failed and why. And you know, I started talking about it a little bit. And I think it was Paul Dobriansky said to me, you know more about this than we do. And I said, and therein lies the problem, because I don't work here.
they should be the experts.
Yeah, exactly. From that perspective, it was bad. There was a lot of movement in Congress. Congress knew that things were failing. And we had gotten Murtha, who died, actually. He was a Democrat from Pennsylvania. And Dana Rohrabacher from California, who was a Republican. They had engineered an $800,000 appropriation, and we were going to get some of it because we were going to go ahead and get a production sharing agreement and start pumping oil. And then the fiscal crisis hit. So when that happened, what Congress did is they rescinded all of the unspent money, you know, anything that was not spent, and all of the kind of promissory funding, and that got sort of usurped in that. And it was, so we had a lot of ups and downs with this. I was by far not the only one. I mean, there were great congressional, one, Tom Colburn, who was a physician from Oklahoma. He was really upset about this. He hired somebody to go over there and kind of give him intelligence about why things were falling apart. So it wasn't only me, but I look back now and I'm thinking, if I wasn't so consumed with the day to day, and we had problems every day, I really had a sense of what had to be done. And I regret not stepping up and really saying to President Bush, put me in charge of this.
Yeah.
Because I can deliver in 6 weeks. I can deliver something to you that you can be proud of, and then we'll go on from there. But I regret not doing that. It's one of the big regrets I have of this whole thing.
Well, although it's also true, as you said earlier, that all the right things, or many of the right things, were reported to Biden directly, and it didn't necessarily change his mind. So. Yeah. You know, I know you're very persuasive, but you just, you know, these top leaders, you know, have so many people talking in their ears, and they're so good at acting like they're listening. And half the time, I think I've met with enough senior people, myself over the years, that half the time it's clear to me they're thinking about something else or their next meeting or lunch or whatever it is. And you can, it doesn't, in some ways, it doesn't matter how you say it or who you are. If you happen to get somebody at the wrong time or the next person says to them, oh, that sounded really nice, Mr. President, but blah, 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 blah. And so it's kind of amazing to me that things work as well as they do, given those dynamics.
You know, I think that's absolutely right. It's kind of like, just, you know, what kind of a mood are people in? And you're absolutely right.
We like to think it's about the best policy and all that business, but sometimes it's much more pedestrian.
Yeah, I agree. I think for me, though, it's just to see now what we've left behind. Michael, I didn't mean to interrupt you. You were going to say something.
Did you testify a lot in Congress?
Well, the Republican hearings have just started. And what the Republicans want to do, they want to embarrass the president. You know, that's all they care about. And really what they care about is the evacuation.
Right.
So that's the focus. And right now, McCall, who's heading this up, he's in a showdown with the State Department because the State Department can't produce any information. They can't and they won't. So he's given them a date certain. If they don't, he's going to subpoena them. It'll be a legal case. The bottom line is that right now, I mean, I'm dealing right now with, there was an earthquake in Turkey, and the earthquake in Turkey hit the Afghan refugee center really directly. Mm. And this is where we brought a lot of people out after the collapse. We put them in these lily pads in the Arab countries. Abu Dhabi has one, Turkey has another. And, you know, we were supposed to bring these people to the U.S. and they've been languishing since 2021. I'm talking to people in Turkey right now. And one guy was instrumental to us and to the U.S. He helped negotiate, which was a failed project, but it was the Taipei pipeline. And this guy was unbelievable. He's so smart, so lovely to deal with. We got him out by the skin of his teeth. It was just literally, I mean, he was very lucky to get out. The Taliban were definitely after him. And he's been in Turkey. He and a friend decided they would go to the northern part of Turkey. They just kind of had it in the refugee center. So they took a trip, and that's when the earthquake hit. He said he came back. And for the last 2 weeks, he's been digging mass graves because most of the Afghan families lost everybody. So I'm writing a letter to Blinken and the Republicans, and I'm basically saying, get these people out of Turkey. Get the Afghans out of Turkey. Bring them to the U.S. Embassy, process their damn passports, get them on a plane, and get them here.
Yeah.
That's what my letter is going to say. There is no imagination among the State Department, and I think the Republicans are really picking this up. No interest. You know, what they'll say is, well, these SIVs are in progress. I'm saying, you know, I mean, I've never, the SIVs, the special immigrant visas, are primarily for interpreters. These guys were vetted by the U.S. military 6 ways to Sunday.
Yeah.
They're the highest security that we have. Those clearances are unbelievable. You know, you're not going to embed an interpreter with the U.S. military. I mean, my interpreter, his family was interviewed. His family had to go through background checks before they hired him. Why we can't, you know, in the State Department saying, well, we can't fingerprint them and we can't. What else do they have to do? Fingerprint. Oh, we can't issue passports. I said, no, you can't, because we don't have an embassy in Afghanistan. So, I mean, I think what we're going to have to do, I mean, this is what I would do. I would throw some crazy money at the Taliban. They need it. They're broke. Throw some money at them. Tell them that we're going to bring American planes into Bagram and we're going to take 100,000 people out. And if they try to stop us, we're going to bomb the shit out of Kabul. So let's leave it at that. And, you know, but the State Department, no, we don't know. Yeah, we have to do that. Yeah. Really? how in the world do you keep saying you're going to have to issue passports and you can't when you don't have an embassy in a country that can do that? That is just, I don't want to hear that anymore, because that's
And what Biden doesn't want to do himself, I'm sure, is have the topic of Afghanistan ever come up again, ideally. And so to do something like you described would be a go against that. And it would also be politically risky, and he'd probably get slammed by the Republicans for giving the Taliban money. Oh, I thought you cared about women's rights, you know, blah, blah, blah. And if there was a problem, if one American died doing that, then he'd get slammed and it would be in the news and all the press would be there. And, you know, politically speaking, leaving aside what's right, you know, he, like any other president, wants to move on from a bad situation and focus on a bunch of other stuff.
David, I think you're absolutely so 100% right. But, you know, it's awful because my interpreter, his family, and this is very typical. The only reason I'm mentioning it is because this is not an unusual story. The Taliban have been after my interpreter for a long time. And they actually went after his family. They expropriated the family's home. So the family has had this home. Most Afghans, you know, their properties are passed down through the generations. You know, they inherited things from their parents. So this family's, this home has been in the family for a long time. It's not, I mean, this family is not wealthy by any stretch of the, you know, they're very working class. We would call them working class. They're like kind of working Pashtun people. Mm-hmm. The one of the brothers, so the family had to leave. They've been holed up in the basement of a relative's house. And there's the mother, the father, two brothers, a wife. There's about eight people. They've been in the basement since 2021. Mm. And one of the brothers almost had a nervous breakdown. He said, I can't do this anymore. So my interpreter raised money, paid a smuggler to get his brother to Iran. And then his brother was going to go from Iran into Europe. The brother gets to Iran and the Iranians don't want Afghans. So the Iranian police arrest the brother and they threaten the brother and they say, we're either going to send you to Syria to fight or Lebanon. Pick your choice, either or, you're going to fight. And so the brother is terrified. My interpreter then goes out and gets another job, pays the Afghan smuggler to bring him back into Kabul and has to pay the Afghan smuggler twice because the Afghan smuggler is then thinking of turning the brother over to the Taliban, which will give him, you know, the smuggler double the fee. So this is, again, it's not that uncommon. I mean, these stories are just all over the place. And
incredible.
To walk away from that is, you know, these are people that helped us.
Well, yeah, it's completely morally indefensible. There's no question about it.
Yeah.
You know, Mike, I would suggest that you send the recording of this out to our whole group. Yeah. And what I would recommend
my rant.
don't say to them, please listen to this and watch it. Say, watch this. I would put it in a declarative way because everybody's busy. We're all running around, blah, blah, blah. But I would make it something that should be a top priority. And the other thing, this is up to you, Suzanne. How about if you pick a really effective reporter, you know, and you go talk to them and publicize some of this, or you send this video conversation to a person in the press?
You know, here's... this is a big problem. One of the people we got out was a New York Times reporter who had been, he's Afghan. Michael, you have a friend too. I was thinking of her. this guy worked for the Times and we got him to Mexico and then he made his way to Harvard. You know, my daughter's a journalist and she's with the Nieman Center for Journalism at Harvard. So they got him a fellowship for a year. And I said to her, this guy needs to go back to the New York Times and tell the Times to hire him, because after a year, I don't know what's going to happen to him.
Yeah.
And the Times has to start, you know, I could have a story for the New York Times every 5 minutes. I would have another story.
Yeah.
I could have them interview witnesses. I could have them. And I just, somebody just alerted me to a proposal, an RFP, that were looking for Afghan journalists, but they wanted Afghan journalists in Pakistan to start reporting. I said, I have a better idea. I'm going to get Afghan journalists, you know, that are here that can actually feel a lot freer to report. And they have.
Well, and the other thing that's tricky about this time we're in is, as you said earlier, the only one of the ways that you could get publicity about all this is the Republicans could like it because it would make Biden and the Democrats look bad. And so it must be tricky for you because obviously you don't want to help the Republicans make Biden look bad, even if this particular issue is, you know, something that should be a light should be shown on.
Well, you know, it's a tricky thing because the bottom line is the major papers aren't interested.
Yeah.
The editorial boards are not interested. And if the editorial boards aren't interested, it doesn't happen.
Yeah.
So what I'm thinking is something will happen. My military contacts tell me we've got about 6 months before an attack will be launched against us again. That's what they're saying. Given what we left, given only what we forget about everything else, just the capacity that we left the enemy to attack. They've got software, they've got computer systems, they've got intel. I mean, you name it, we left it. So they have that capacity. Once we're attacked again, all of this will restart, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But the other thing I'm thinking of, and David, it's a great suggestion that you have. It's kind of like you just don't know how to interest the press. I mean, these editorial boards get to be very tricky. But well, I have a problem.
Wonder, is it something that needs to kind of bubble up from somewhere other than a big paper editorial board that somehow you get somebody who's effective enough as a reporter at a smaller newspaper maybe or something to really get the story out there, or you get some number of people to just watch this recording. I'm not kidding.
Oh, go ahead.
I have a reporter to hook you up with.
That's the Afghan woman, and I'm concerned about her.
No. A guy who lives in Minnesota, he's writing some articles for us about adapted sports, but he writes all kinds of articles. His name's Reed Forgrave, and I'll hook you up with him.
Perfect.
He's written for the Times Magazine and all this.
Oh, wow, that's great. Yeah, I think the Republicans, I mean, I was talking to a colleague of mine. I said, Matt, what are you going to do if they subpoena you? He said, oh, I hate the Republicans. I'm going to just tell them pass the Afghan Adjustment Act. I'm going to walk out of the hearing. That's all I'm going to say. But at this point, they're the only game in town.
Right.
And if they're going to, you know, you hate to say it, Biden needs to be embarrassed over this. This has all kinds of reverberations throughout the world for us. This is a horrible way that we, you know, this is very bad for us. I mean,
are you gonna write a book, Suzanne?
I am. I mean, right now, I'm writing articles. It's like you guys know I'm not the thing I don't like to do is sit down and write. I like to just be in the fray here and rattle cages a little bit.
Yeah.
But I have learned so much over this.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
it's really important. I mean, I think getting this stuff out there, a book, a reporter or whatever is important. And if, I mean, I agree with you, if it embarrasses the Biden administration, that's fine. If they respond correctly, it won't necessarily be a horrible thing. If they just stonewall and act, you know, stupid, then it could be more damaging. But if Biden responds, the administration responds, and the State Department in an effective way, then it could undercut investigation by Republicans, just being political for a minute, and they would then say, okay, you know, yeah, this is something that we could have done a lot better, but here's what we're going to do to begin to fix it. You know, yeah. Your thing about getting people out and all of that. And then they could take the moral high ground back, because the Republicans, in my mind, are the last ones that I want to see having the moral high ground, because they don't deserve it, and they don't care about the moral high ground. It's all for political purposes.
I agree. Yeah. I mean, Biden's been a real disappointment on Afghanistan. I mean, I have to say, he's just been awful. And I think his appointees are just, when the collapse happened here in New York, the first thing we confronted, we got 300 unaccompanied Afghan minors that came into Kennedy on a plane. Mm. And they ended up in a refugee center in Harlem, and we couldn't get access to them. So I got lawyers involved. I said, we're going to sue these people and we're going to get access to these kids. And essentially it was a federal facility, and the federal facility said, these are, you know, vulnerable populations. I said, tell me who in your facility speaks Pashto, Dari, or Farsi. Right. I don't know. Right. And of course, nobody did. I said, well, how are you even talking to these kids? Well, we're using Google Translator. I said, that's against your contract. You're not allowed to use Google Translator. According to your federal contract, you have to have speaking interpreters. So the Afghan community here in New York, they went ahead and certified a lot of families to be foster families. Mm. And the federal agency wouldn't accept this. Mm. They said, well, you know, we have our own network of foster families. I said, are they Afghan? Of course they were.
No.
You know, it just went on and on and on. And Washington was completely unresponsive. I said, well, you know what? I don't care if they're unresponsive, because they're going to meet me in federal court and we'll sort it out in court in front of a judge. But this is the caliber of appointees. Biden is really, he can do better than that. I mean, he does not have good people managing this problem for him.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like it.
Yeah. But at any rate, guys, thank you for listening to all of this. I appreciate it. And
all right. Thank you, Suzanne. It's so important. I really hope you can get the word out about this stuff. It's just so important.
Yeah, unbelievable. And I'm sure you could have talked. I mean, obviously, you could talk a lot more about what's going on. You know, the thing, you know, we talk about Biden being embarrassed, the Republicans, but, you know, it's individuals' lives, right, that are at stake. Oh. And that's, you know, I mean, I have one friend, right, who's been hiding with her family. I don't know that she'll ever get out, you know. I don't know, and all these other people. So
this is a regime that's getting much worse, really quickly.
I'm sure.
They're really not stopping. I'm actually surprised, because I thought they would be a little bit more moderated, because some of the leaders are somewhat educated.
Well, especially because you'd think they'd at least want to get foreign aid in there or something.
Yeah, I know. I guess they don't care. You know, I don't think they do. And I think they're getting money from somewhere. They've got to be. I mean, how are they paying themselves?
Yeah.
Some money's coming in, and God only knows where that's coming from.
Probably from Russia.
Maybe China.
Yeah. Well, China seems to think, I mean, you know, the Chinese went in, they got a concession in Afghanistan. They got the copper mine concession. And when they got that, an American company had bid, Phelps Dodge had bid on it, you know, world-class copper mining company in the U.S. The Chinese got it. Karzai promised them power. I said, there is no power. Karzai can't promise you power. There is no, you know, where is he going to get it?
Yeah.
Of course, the Chinese go in and there's no power. So how in the world do you mount an industrial activity without power? And they sit on it for 4 or 5 years. They do nothing because they can't. There's no power. And then they walk away. And, you know, Afghanistan loses all kinds of revenue. And you know, Phelps Dodge would have gone in there. We would have worked with Phelps Dodge. I mean, we would have got, you know, we would have tried to at least provide power to, you know, we would have gotten the thing going.
Yeah.
But the Chinese are saying they're going to go back in and do business development. I mean, doing business development with the Taliban you can't get any legitimate board of directors to go along with that.
Right.
I mean, you know, there's no reputable company that would be able to do that in the world.
Well, and that's why it's hard to imagine, unfortunately, the U.S. Putting out a hand to the Taliban in terms of money or anything else.
Yeah.
Politically, I'm not saying it's not maybe it's the right thing to do, as you said, but politically and in terms of the press and the Republicans, everybody would go crazy.
They would go nuts. Yeah, they would go nuts. I mean, I think even the human rights groups now are having problems. Because the Taliban, they keep doing these repressive things. I think the worst thing that they've done, and then, you know, we can stop. About 6 months ago, they called in all the judges. The Taliban brought everybody back into Kabul. And they said to the judges, forget about what the Americans taught you. That's gone. We're not going to do that. We're now a country of Sharia law. And here is the justification for the murder of anybody who supported the U.S. and its efforts. So if anybody comes before you to adjudicate anything, you have this ability now. We are going to go ahead with it. We think about 20, I mean, I think the military guys that track everybody over there, they say that about 2,500 people have been killed so far. And now, they're starting to get videos of beheadings.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah. So this is a, you know, how the Chinese think they're going to go back in there and do business with these people. I just don't get it.
Yeah. Well, thank you again. This is great, Suzanne. It's really good of you to take this.
Always a pleasure seeing you guys and great questions.
Unbelievable, yeah. Suzanne. Just
really incredible stuff. Jesus. Yeah. Oh, man. All right.
It's awful.
Yeah. Thank you. Awful.
Yeah. Thanks very much.
We'll look forward to next month.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll get someone. Likewise. On. Okay. Yeah. Bye.
Okay.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.